she don't love me some. Yeah, my baby don't love me some. The way I love my baby, I know she's gonna love me some. Oh, and she throws her loving arm around me. Lord, it's just like a circle going round the sun. In all the whole world, it ain't but one. You're like a circle going round the sun. You're like a circle going round the sun. You're like a circle going round the sun. Feeling like a circle going around the sun. Feeling like a circle around the sun. Reading like a circle around the sun. Feeling like a circle going around the sun. Around the sun.
All right, we've got a nice full room. I think we're going to go ahead and get started.
Okay.
So I'm going to just start with a brief sort of introduction. My name's Tiff Beatty. I'm the Program Director of Arts, Culture, and Public Policy at the National Public Housing Museum. We are the first cultural institution devoted to telling the story of public housing in the United States. Our mission at the museum is to preserve, promote, and propel the right of all people to a place where they can live and prosper, a place to call home. We believe that art, culture, and everyday stories and objects can and should be a catalyst for spreading what we call civic love, or simply the capacity to care for each other. And that asking the right questions can lead to creating better policies and ultimately a better society. Our oral history archive documents the stories of generations of people and families who've lived, struggled, thrived, and protested before being violently removed and displaced from public housing. Our archive includes Section 8 voucher holders and homeowners in Inglewood. Our work also includes documenting and interpreting the history of land, home ownership, the histories of social and economic justice with artists like Sanika Lewis Johnson, NPHM's 2021 Artist as Instigator. And we also believe that just collecting and amplifying everyday stories can challenge misconceptions of public housing, encourage empathy for the people who live there, give us insight into a history that's often forgotten or intentionally ignored, and also help us reimagine the future of housing for us all. So we want to thank you from all of the NPHM staff and board members for joining us. We know it's a bit of a sketchy summer evening and we're not sure about the storms and all of that, but we're all here now. And so we just want to welcome you into this space. We want to celebrate Dr. Cranston Knight and his online exhibition, Silent Voices Among Us, a montage of Chicago's West Side, a photojournalistic series by Dr. Cranston Knight, who grew up in the Henry Horner Homes, formerly located in Chicago's now gentrifying near West Side. Dr. Knight's photos taken in Austin and Garfield Park, located just a few miles west, document decades of systemic inequities, which persist to the present day, not just on the West Side, but across the country. So in addition to hearing from Dr. Knight, we'll listen to an excerpt of his oral history, as well as stories from other Henry Horner residents. And then we'll open it up to a conversation with you all, exploring a few questions: what went wrong with public housing, what worked, and what you wish had been done differently. And ultimately, we hope learn what history can teach us about how to create development without displacement. Can you remove the slide for me? You can remove the slide. I want to start with the land acknowledgement to recognize the Indigenous people who are past, present, and current, past, current, and future caretakers of the occupied land we call the United States. While we may all be coming to this virtual event from many different places, the land where I sit, where NPHM resides, and which is documented in this exhibition, is recognized as the traditional lands of the Council of Three Fires, the Ojibwe, the Odawa, and the Potawatomi people. This land sits on water, Lake Michigan, the original highway that connects the people without borders. That said, several other tribes have called this land home. We also recognize the Miami, the Ho-Chunk, the Peoria, the Menominee, the Menominee, the Sac, and the Fox. We recognize John Baptiste Point du Sable, who was regarded as the first permanent non-Indigenous settler of what would later become Chicago, and his wife, Kitty Hawa Point du Sable, a Potawatomi woman. And now I would like to introduce Dr. Cranston Cedric Knight. Dr. Knight is a historian, photographer, writer, and former resident of Chicago's Henry Horner Homes. He received his doctorate in history from Loyola University Chicago. His areas of interest are decolonization studies, modernity, and international affairs. Dr. Knight has taught at several colleges and universities during his career in Chicago. He's founded and led human rights organizations. He lectures on many topics, including contemporary history, education, and foreign affairs. His writings have appeared in both journals and anthologies. Dr. Knight has been taking photos for years, with his earliest memories harkening back to his early years in public housing. He first took a photography course at the Henry Horner Boys Club when he was 10 years old. He became intrigued by the camera and darkroom, though it was much later in life, through his work as an educator, Dr. Knight was reminded about the power of images to capture people's attention, start conversations, and promote action. This collection of work was taken in 2018 and 2019 in the Austin and Garfield Park communities. If you haven't gotten a chance to check out the exhibit, we'll drop it in the chat. It's an online exhibit, so you can, oh, it's in there. You can definitely check it out sort of while you're listening or later, but please do check it out. Check out the photography, which you'll see featured in here just a little bit. But now I'm gonna hand it over to Dr. Cranston Knight. If you could just talk a little bit about your relationship to these communities that you photographed, and if there's anything that you wanna say about your motivations for creating this, or anything that you discovered along the way or since about, yeah, your work.
Oh, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here this evening to, excuse me, to discuss a very interesting period in my life and to relive a lot of what I grew up, the milieu between Union Park and Garfield Park, and that whole stretch of land that eventually became Henry Horner and other and another housing project. I became interested and wanted to reconnect to the community. I had taught there at the Malcolm X College for 10 years. After I finished my doctorate at Loyola, I wanted to go back and work in the community and give back. And I thought the best way to do that was to get into the classroom, work with the students as intensely as possible, and to see what comes from that. And a lot of students went on to do some amazing things. And I hope that one day their work will be chronicled, whether it's in an anthology, church setting. They've done some amazing things. So I've been glad to have been part of their lives. The photography, I got really interested in going back to the community, not as an educator, but as a photographer, and just to revisit the area in terms of looking through the lens, what's there, what has changed, and looking at change over time. So out I go with my camera, and a lot had changed, and I was really surprised at the sheer number of buildings which were abandoned that were still standing. They told a story. I think a building which is no longer occupied has a history in and of itself. It's a living organism that says at one time there were individuals who dwelled here. And I am the cornucopia of those voices. So looking at those voices coming from those different buildings which I took gave me a lot of insight, because I looked at also the surroundings. I looked at the grass area. I looked at the areas which had been formerly occupied, areas which were crumbling, areas where there were antennae for public television or television, whatever someone was looking at, and then trying to put those together and a form that says, this is who we are now, and then asking the next question, which I'll do probably in the next few weeks, go back and do another shooting. Now it's been now 2 years, what has changed? So now I'm looking at change over time in my photography. It's those type of voices, which I think have been negated, marginalized, pushed aside. We don't read about, we don't see, we hear about the violence, but we don't see the people. We don't see the places that individuals go by every single day. I'm looking for things in terms of what's accessibility in terms of groceries, accessibility in terms of pharmacies, accessibility in terms of mental health and physical health. And they're miles away from anyone. You literally live in a time capsule where everything goes around you, the highways bypass you. Most people can live in the city all their lives, go to Oak Park, you get off at 290, and you never realize that you've just passed literally thousands of people. Of course, that's done on purpose, but literally you can live your entire life in a place like Oak Park and never realize that you've just passed miles upon miles of individuals who live an entirely different life than yourself. and will never have any accessibility that they will define as normal. So with that in mind, I want to do this particular photo project.
Yeah, you talked about this is not something, or these are not sort of landscapes or people that maybe documented very well, or you know, this is something that's different. How did the people or the community respond to you taking these photos, and how did you interact with folks?
It was very interesting. I decided one Tuesday morning, you know, I'm going to go out and do some shooting. I didn't have a lot on my agenda. I got my equipment together, get in the van, drive across town. And I run across a couple of individuals that we'll see a little bit later, perhaps in one of the shots. And I was, you know, had my camera in front of me. One of the guys looked at me and said, you know, so I didn't think that the FBI had infiltrated this far already, you know, and coming into the community. I said, oh no, I'm just here to do some recording. I really want to look at the community itself. And so he said, great, you know, take a photo with me. I'm just going to act natural. And I thought that was pretty interesting. But he acknowledged me. We acknowledged each other. No sense of hostility. Just, hey, fine. Just shoot me natural. And I thought, okay, I'll do that. I can do that. I'll take a picture of you in your natural state. So he got back on his phone and got a photo of him. So it was up to two guys. Actually, two guys were sitting there. In the beginning, you see a photo. It shows a bridge, and then you see the downtown area. And I call that I called that particular piece Distant Shores, because I can remember as a child growing up in Horner, and we always saw downtown. So I lived on the sixth floor, and my window faced the downtown buildings. And that was another world. So the world that I lived in stretched from, once again, from Union Park to Garfield. But very few people went downtown. Occasionally, I would just decide to walk downtown. But there were very few people of color in downtown area. For all practical purposes, you were banned. There were no signs, of course, that said you were not allowed. But you knew pretty much that wasn't the place that you were supposed to be. And so I wanted to take a picture of that distant world that people see every single day, of the glitz, of the beauty, of the power, and also the majesty and the money that exists downtown to build the buildings which exist there that would never be part of their lives. And that's that type of dichotomy, that schism between power of have and have not, for me, could not be more stark, because you see, now on one side, you see the one of the hospitals, which is Rush. You see Wilderness Towers. You see the other building that's there. It's a whole world of plenty versus what I was sitting in taking photos of, or the community which I had known even before I had left that particular area. So that habit, that distance between have and have not, it's actually grown exponentially. And that's a photo that I really wanted to show, that it's the difference between those who have power and money and make decisions and those who are left out of the decision-making process.
Yeah, that's making me think of your, you know, you studied decolonization and, you know, history, and I'm thinking about your poetry and your writing, and how does that intersect? I'm curious if there are cross-pollinations in your work. Like, do you see sort of things coming up from your studying of history that come up in what you're interested in as a photographer or as a poet, as a writer?
Yeah, I'll start back with my poetry. I started writing poetry very young. I was introduced to poetry in grammar school. I went to what would be considered now a magnet school, actually. It was called Emerson. And Emerson Grammar School, all of the teachers there, well, there were some white teachers there, but all the teachers of color had graduated from HBCs. most held master's degrees, but they could not teach in a Chicago public school system because it was highly segregated. So the only place they could find jobs were in segregated schools. And I was lucky to have met these really brilliant individuals. My music teacher was a concert pianist. And he had wanted to be with the Chicago Symphony, but because of the fact that he was Black, he was not allowed to do so. So I got to listen to him play Chopin, Bach, some stuff by Beethoven, a lot of the jazz pieces. He introduced us to all kinds of stuff by John Coltrane, by Monk, by any number of other artists. An education would I have not would not have received, but he never talked about the issue of race. He simply said, this is the music that human beings have the ability to create, and each of us have a voice. And I will be forever grateful to this particular individual. My English teacher taught us poetry. He loved Langston Hughes, and we would write stuff by Langston. Does Edna St. Vincent Millay, whose poetry I still like to this day. And he would have us simply write down your thoughts. How do you feel? And then teach us, you know, structure a little bit, and then just say free verse, do your thing. He wanted us to get what was inside out. He said, some of you can journal, some of you can write poetry. So I started writing poetry really early and chronicling some of the things which I saw. I really enjoy poetry. In fact, I still write poetry now. That became a central point when I started to get very interested in photography, because I don't find much difference between the written word and an image which I will take with the camera. It's all coming from me. The camera is simply a mechanism, much like a pen or a pencil and paper, to formulate a creative format for what's inside of me. How do I see the world? What's my vision of the world? Using cadence, sometimes I'll just simply use free verse. I need to get in what's inside out so that I can communicate with someone else. So for a long period of time, we had, I'm trying to think what they were called in those days. They're called spoken word, but they weren't called that during the day. We simply have a poetry night, and you could get up and you could read your work. And I also got up and would read what we had to say. There was some critique. Love, but more than that, people would say, yeah, I felt like that too. And I play piano. So you might have someone playing piano. Earth, Wind, the individuals who eventually became part of Earth, Wind, and Fire lived in the housing projects, which was right next to me. I lived in 150, they lived in 140. They had a trio where they started out with bass, drum, piano. And we would do things, and it was great. So everybody's there. There were some people who were on trumpet. There were some individuals who played piano. And then there were those individuals who either attempted to write short stories, or actually could write short stories. And then there are those of us who were poets. And that gave us a sense of community in terms of the arts. It wasn't quite called that at the time, but it was arts. And we got together and we were able to exchange our sense of what we saw that was going on at the time, whether it was a raid which had taken place, and there were many police raids, whether someone had gotten hurt, whether someone had lost their apartment. We were able to articulate that in our music and also in our poetry. Eventually, I was able to articulate that in the photography.
Yeah, I love how you just casually sort of dropped the Earth, Wind, and Fire coming from your community,
And I'm saying that because I was speaking to someone about an hour ago who said, "Hey, Earth, Wind, and Fire," and I said, "You know, I grew up with those guys, and they were called the Morris Trio at the time, and the dad was a podiatrist. It was the only physician that I had known at that particular time. He was a podiatrist. Got his son very interested in music. I ran track with Rodine. And we were just kicking it. We were just kids in the community, and eventually formed a group, that trio first, and then eventually they went on to do other things.
Yeah, I love it. I mean, it's also so common when I hear about public housing history that everyone knows someone famous that came from their community, especially artists, musicians. So yeah, there's something to that for sure. I'm glad that you're talking about your history at Henry Horner. We are going to transition to a little excerpt of your oral history. And what I learned as I was looking into doing some of the research for this with my colleagues was you were actually, and you say this in your story, you were one of the first residents of Henry Horner Homes. You, in fact, moved there when it was still under construction. So when we're looking at the years that you've lived there, it's actually technically before, we are saying, at least in this exhibit, that they were completed. So it's just very interesting to hear, I think, especially from your perspective, someone who was there from the very beginning. Is there anything you want to say? Because we chose the clip, so we'll show what we want to include as a part of this conversation. But if there's anything you want to say before we transition into that
Sure.
clip.
I'll just make it very quickly. My family lived there before the housing project. So there was just two-story buildings for, all over the place. I lived across the street from Bernie School, and it was just a community.
Yeah.
And one day they came in and said that they were going to be building some new places that our family should move to. I mean, I was a kid, so I'm only paraphrasing this coming from my parents. That we're going to be given vouchers. That community was going to be torn down. A new one was going to be set up, and then with that voucher, we could come back and live in the community. Now that community was high density, but very, very how can I say it? Very, very multicultural. So you had people from Mexico. You had people from Cuba, you had people from Puerto Rico, you had individuals from Central Europe, from Poland, from Scandinavia, from there were individuals who were Jewish, who were from Russia. So you had a Russian Jewish community. You had the I'm trying to think that they were called the they weren't slums. They were flat houses. And so you had that. And then you just had a whole community of individuals from all over the place. The undertaker was white, as it was strange. The barber that I used to go to in those days was also white. So you had this very cultural community that had to change.
Yeah. Thank you. Please follow along as we're sharing your story. And if there's anything you want to add at the end or expand on, we would be happy to continue some of this conversation. And then we'll hear from some other residents of Henry Horner Homes. We'll talk a little bit about the history. And these stories will be sprinkled without or throughout. Some of this is also on the online exhibition page, so you can also follow along there. But just to set this up before we play this clip, this is just some CHA history. So between 1957 and 1968, the Chicago Housing Authority, also known as CHA, embarked on an ambitious expansion of public housing units, adding an additional 16,000 units of public housing, more than doubling the stock that existed between 1935 and 1956. Completed in the first year of the expansion, the Henry Horner Homes was located in Chicago's Near West Side neighborhood and contained 920 units. In 1961, the Henry Horner extensions were constructed just east of the original Horner apartments. So now we're going to transition to hear a little bit of Dr. Knight's oral history, in which he talks about his experiences growing up in Horner homes in the 50s and 60s.
Lights went out all the time, cold. I can remember sleeping in my clothing at night and also my coats. My mom doing the best that she could to try to keep us warm. When they decided the electricity or whatever would happen to electricity went out, you couldn't get on the grass. If you got on the grass, they charged you $15. if you tried to leave the housing project, because we're always told you were just there to save money and become middle class, you could leave. But every time my mom kept getting a job, they kept upping our rent. So we're trapped and you couldn't leave. So lots of people didn't leave, not because they didn't want to leave, but because the system trapped them. Because every time they figured out that you could make more money, they increased your rent, which trapped you there and there was no place else to go. Did we hide people? Yeah, we did. My cousins needed a place to stay. They stayed with us. Did we tell anybody? No. Did we tell the landlord? No. Was our neighbors going to tell the landlord? No. They had relatives who were staying with them. People didn't have place to stay or they lost their place. So there was this communal, we're going to take care of you. But that also caused pressures because we are on top of each other. And that population stress, particularly buildings upward, created a particular stress that we would feel. So we would take, I became very violent when I was young, and that violence played out in terms of fights. So, you know, and people always, you know, I'm the jefe. No, it's not gonna go down like that, guy. No, you can't get on my corner. Since when did that become your? I'm not getting off your corner. Okay, so you're going to get a beat down. Okay, you have to be down. I'm not getting off your corner. And you didn't get off that corner because, and I hate to say it, your manhood was at stake. We weren't that young, but you understood the concept of the fact that you were a man and you could not run from another man. And that meant you were going to have to get beat up. And that meant you were going to have to fight. And if you're going to have to fight, you fought. And I can remember fighting and being beat up and my getting home and my papi would say, what did you do to him? I didn't fight him, go back out. You go fight him. Then you come back. Then you're okay. And I would go back out, I would fight him, get the heck beat out of me, come home, papi would say, okay, you fought, you're good. And so you sort of learn this whole concept of in terms of masculinity and violence because it was so much a part of this code of this is mine and this is mine and you're this and you got to prove your worth as a young man. And so a lot of it came to that, so not so much through sexuality, but more through the fact that you were able to take care of yourself. If you're walking down the street and there's two guys walking down the street, you better not dare cross the street. You better walk between them. You don't walk on the other side of them. You've got to, you look them in the eyes and you walk right between them. Not to do so, it was going to be a fight anyway. Didn't matter. You're going to fight if you cross the street. You're going to fight if you went around them. You're going to fight if you walk between them. You're going to fight. Fought.
When did you realize that, I mean, you kind of, you know, said this a lot in this past, you know, several minutes that we were talking, but when did you start to realize that the community had changed and was starting to change?
67.
Tell me a little
66,
bit.
66. 1966, things were starting to change across the country in terms of the civil rights movement. But that wasn't the North. In the North, there was no civil rights movement. That's the South. In the North, there was the urban poverty. No jobs, no place to go, a lot of young men on the corner. And you begin to get revolutionary groups. And interesting enough, that revolution in Cuba, that became very much talked about in our community. Mind you, we're supposed to be this backward group of individuals who don't read or write, but that was there because why? It was on the television all the time. We're always glued. There were only three television stations, NBC, ABC, and CBS, so you couldn't miss it. And this concept of liberation, of being free, was literally swelling through the community. And one evening, the police had increased their patrols in our community. And someone said, out of nowhere, there was a sniper in your building. Okay, you can't come out. And we're going, what do you mean you can't come? We can't come out, you can't come out. The police came in buses. I remember looking out my window, there's these school buses, all the police get out of the bus. And a shot was fired about 8 o'clock and they opened up on our building with submachine guns and M16s and they shot all the windows out. And That's when I knew my stepfather was a very, very brave man. He went downstairs. He was a Navy person. He'd been in the Navy from 44 to 45 in the Pacific, fighting against the Japanese. And he goes down, and for every practical reason, they should have killed him. He opens this door up with this spotlight and says, "I'm not leaving until you stop shooting." And I remember it was an Irish priest said, "If you don't go in, they're going to kill you right now." And his response was, "I will not leave. You are shooting on women and children. You did not evacuate this building in any form, shape, or fashion. You're wrong." And they were afraid of him. I mean, they just should have killed him, but they didn't. But they did stop shooting. And other buildings were fired on. From that point on, we had a riot every single summer. People were very aware of Newark, Detroit, the Watts riot. We had a huge riot again in 68. By the time the community was destroyed, by 68, the community was burned to the ground. There was no more stores, there was nothing.
Right. Any memories coming back from just hearing that oral history? Anything you want to add or correct yourself? Sometimes that happens, right? We hear ourselves and we're like,
No corrections needed. It was after the Watts riots, every single summer, my mom would make sure that there was a lot of water. So the tub was constantly filled. She would take cans, fill them with food, which were non-perishable. She would buy a lot of rice, potatoes. She would find, she would use these large soup cans, which you could buy, and make sure that we had ample amount of water, because the first thing they were going to cut was your electricity. Next thing they were going to cut was your utilities. The next thing they were going to cut was water. So those were two things you were not going to have. And because my dad had been in the service, he was very instrumental in making sure that we had provisions. I remember when the military came in, and they came in 67, they came in again in 68. The first thing they did was they cut all the water. And so you didn't have anything to drink. They understood enough that population which did not have water was going to become extremely violent. And so the following morning, they would open up the fire hydrants. None of the males were allowed to come out, but my mom and my sisters came out, and they were allowed to get buckets of water, which they could bring back upstairs. But that was it. All the stores had been burned down. And so eventually they knew at some point in time, they were going to have to bring in food. If not, you're going to have some real serious problems. People who have nothing to lose is a dangerous bunch. And they understood that very clearly. You got a lot of individuals who just got from Vietnam. It was the 82nd Airborne. I never liked it. I never did like weekend warriors who were National Guard people. The Airborne were really professional. Violent, but they were professional. Then you knew not to cross them. They would ride through the under the L of Lake Street and their Jeeps. M60 machine gun on top, and the loudspeaker that said, "If you come out after 6 o'clock, you shall be shot." So there's a dust to dawn curfew. And I quickly understood what it meant to live in a third world country when someone imposes, dust to dawn curfews. We understood very quickly what it meant to be a colonialized people. And that's how we refer to ourselves as individuals who are colonialized, who were empathetic and sympathetic to revolt and revolutions across the world.
Yeah.
Also, we understood that very clearly.
Yeah. Yeah, and I mean, that leads us nicely into, I mean, I don't know if it's that clear, but I wasn't alive in, it should be 1969. Oh, 1990, yeah, 1969 is the year that this next period that we're going to talk about, which is like the period after you had left, right? And that was, this is, at least in my mind, an historical known for this kind of energy. And, you know, there was a lot happening on the artistic side, but also on the cultural and political side. And, you know, I feel that those were very intertwined, that you can't really pull those apart, right? That there's this Black Power movement that's happening at the same time that, you know, the Black arts movement is happening and that they're talking to each other and feeding each other. One of the things I love about your oral history in particular is it just, it talks about so much of that revolutionary history, and it really spans. Like, there's lots of joy in your story, but also a lot of hard things to hear. And yeah, it's really a great oral history. I hope that folks listen to it in full. It is on the Silent Voices exhibition website, and that's in the chat as well. And we are going to play a little bit more of those clips next. And I'm going to set up this first one, which is John Pettiford, who was in the Henry Horner homes around this period of time. So by 1969, the one city block Henry Horner annex was completed, both adding 736 and 109 units respectively. John Pettiford reflects on his life during the 70s and 80s at the Henry Horner homes. Like, we might be having some technical.
In around 19. All right, we moved into Henry Horner Homes, which is located on the near west side of the city of Chicago. I was around 8 years old, 7, 8 years old when we moved into them projects, and it was a low income housing. And at that time, a lot of people was moving into the projects because they were very new at that time, and it was pretty much the only area in which the low-income people could actually move to and try to make a life for themselves. So as time progressed, like any poverty-stricken area, the projects, along with any other area which is low-income, start going down. Well, not at that particular time, because we was more of a family in those years, but as time progressed, you'll know that it started going down. We had a lot of activities going on at that time. I mean, we had the Boys Club was there. It was a lot of different other activities that was going on in other areas of Henry Horner Homes. One in particular was the building. Every building had their own specific activities that really kept the kids, you know, out of trouble or off the streets, if you will. But at those times, it really wasn't any gang banging. And I'm talking about the early to mid 70s. And it really wasn't no gang banging, because in those days, you could stay outside until the streetlights came on, and you didn't really have to worry about anything. But, you know, that's not getting ahead of myself. But when I think about those particular times, it was really, really beautiful. Around the late 70s, early 80s, that's when the gang banging started, you know. And it seemed like the times have changed overnight. And that was the end of that era and the beginning of a new era. And, you know, those for a long period of time, you know, it was really, really down or bad, if you will.
By May 1991, vacancy in the Henry Horner Homes hit its peak, with 896 of its units unoccupied. During this time, many of the structural issues in the complexes became exacerbated to a breaking point, with elevators breaking down during the coldest months of the winter, narrow trash chutes clogging and causing dangerous pileups and occasional fires. And with easy access to the building, visitors with ill intentions were able to bring drugs, guns, and gang-related violence into the Henry Horner homes. In the midst of this decline, an organization based out of the Henry Horner Annex called the Henry Horner Mothers Guild protested against the conditions of the building and asserted in court that both the CHA and U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, also known as HUD, had violated federal law by not maintaining a safe and reliable apartment infrastructure or renting out vacant units. By 1995, a consent decree was agreed upon in court, which allowed for the Henry Horner homes to be redeveloped in phases, which helped to minimize displacement and included a one-for-one replacement law. Phase one of demolition and renovation began in 1996. This period of the complex is recalled by Marina Pullum, who moved out of the Henry Horner homes during this phase.
And so it was, a lot of people had moved out. So a lot of the squalors and people, drug addicts, they was coming in and getting into the units, tearing the pipes out, tearing all the different stuff up. And so it literally was like a big hole right here, ice coming off of the building, because this was in the wintertime. Mm-hmm. They was tearing stuff up and the water was overflowing. So they had to move us from up out of that building. That's how I ended up going to 1920 West Washington. That's how I ended up down there while they fixed these units up down here. So I had to move down there, stay down there some years, and then that's how I ended up down here on Maple. I hate moving, and I got a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
So this ain't nobody who you just finna come and get a bag and let's walk down the street. When I moved, we had the big truck. Me and my sister's stuff was on the whole, filled the whole truck up. That's how much stuff we had, and we had threw a whole lot of stuff away.
By 1998, Congress had repealed the one-for-one apartment replacement statute, which would have required the CHA to replace each unit of torn-down public housing. At the same time, the original plans for rehabbing the mid-rise buildings changed to a proposal for mixed-income townhomes, which would become the West Haven Park community, which remains to this day. The replacement of the Henry Horner homes garners a mixed reaction from public housing residents to this day. Marina Pullum and Sharon Jeanette Leggett react to the changes.
I miss it. A lot of people be saying, I'm glad the project's down. I don't. I had so many friends. I got so many friends because of living in Horner. When my sons see me speaking to so many people, he be like, how you know this person? How you know that person? I knew somebody from the 15th floor, the 13th floor, maybe two buildings over on the third floor, the second floor. It was like a big community. Everybody knew everybody. It's not like how it is now. You go outside and you don't know nobody, and you don't know nobody, mama or cousin or nothing. Back then, it was really like it was a knit. Even though later on the buildings ended up being, they turned into something else when drugs came on the scene. But other than that, before any of that happened, everybody was real, real close. Mm-hmm. You could go somewhere and your neighbors will watch your kids, or the lady downstairs will watch your kids. It's nothing like how it is now.
I wouldn't want them to do the high rise, but I would want them to give them the same rights they're giving other communities. If you gonna build a site, let our people just give our people just the same opportunities you give the whites. For real. Don't just give it to the whites. Don't just make it just whites only. Don't move our people out of their community and not make them a promise that you're going to put them back in their community, and don't do it. Put them back in their community like you promised them. You know? Don't take them out of their community and then say you're going to put them back and then don't. Because that's what's making them angry. That's what's making them angry.
Right. Thank you for listening, everyone. So now is the time where we open it up to you all in the room. If you are willing and able to turn on your video, that's great. If not, that's fine. If you have access to the chat and the icons, we will be using those in a bit. But if you can bring the slideshow back, we're going to go through the community agreements. Before we start the conversation, it's always just to agree on our terms. These are, you know, heavy issues, and people will be invested in this conversation as they rightly should be. And so it's just important to make sure we're all on the same page about how we want to share space today. So the first one is listen from the inside out. A gut in your feeling in your gut matters. And I would add your bladder to that. So if you need to leave to use the restroom or whatever you need to do, pay attention to your body and take care of yourself. Engage tension, don't indulge drama. I think that's pretty straightforward. We don't want to use any name calling or harassing folks. You know, we just want to express our ideas and our stories and not to walk away from that tension or that conflict, but you know, to keep it cute. WAIT is an acronym for why am I talking? So anytime you are, and this sort of connects to number four as well, make space, take space. Anytime you're talking, just sort of have a self check-in to make sure, especially if you're an extroverted person, that you're not dominating the conversation. If you're an introverted person, maybe, you know, try to push yourself a little bit to engage a little bit more than you might normally, just to create more balance. And also just to have a bit of an internal conversation, whether you're writing it down or thinking it through, just to make sure that you know what you want to say so that we can make the best use of everyone's time. Be open, period, but be open to learning, be open to, you know, vulnerability. However you feel, you can show up in the space. If you don't feel you can be vulnerable, if you don't feel, you know, you can learn, then you may want to take a step back and just sort of check in with yourself. But there will be, you know, as we have already heard from folks' stories, there's a lot to learn for all of us. Be open to someone else speaking your truth. So that's again, pretty obvious. If you can you know, give some snaps or agree with people in the chat, however you want to, you know, affirm someone that's saying something that you may relate to. We're building, not selling. So when you speak, converse, don't pitch. We're not having any political campaigns today. We're just having some dialogue. The yes and, the both and, you know, your right or your reference point may be different than my reference point. And so it's not to necessarily disagree with people, but just to add perspective. And we want to value the process. We don't necessarily have anything that you all have to accomplish in this conversation. We just want to have an open conversation. So thank you for valuing that process and also assuming best intentions. And despite your intentions, to attend to impact. So you may not have meant something a certain way, but you know, just be conscious of how others in the room may be reading you, and especially if someone expresses something that you know, feels like they were offended or hurt. So just to, you know, create this safe space, it should not be anything that's intimidating, and hopefully it's not. But if there's anything you all want to add or challenge, you can feel free to type that in the chat. If there's something that's on your spirit that you even if it's just the number of the agreement that you really want to lift up and make sure that you know, folks are aligned and that feel you on this agreement, you can also just write that in the chat. And you can also take yourself off mute if you don't have access to the chat and just chime in about anything you would like to add to the community agreement. All right, we can go to the prompts. All right, so we're gonna have a conversation. It's meant to be, again, a community conversation. So everyone is here, is a part of the museum's national, the National Public Housing Museum's community. And you know, we are amplifying the voices of residents through the oral history archive that you heard. So if there are residents in the room, you know, we'd love to hear about your personal experience. If you don't wanna talk about that, that's fine as well. We just wanna sort of engage you in conversation, everyone in the room as they feel comfortable. But these are the questions that we're asking because these are some of the things that we are wrestling with as a museum and that people ask us, what went wrong with public housing? What worked? And what do you wish had been done differently? Before we get into that, I just wanna make sure that we have a little bit of a process with, you can either raise your hand, write your name in the chat or write stack in the chat. Write, I have a question, however you wanna let us know that you have a question, and then we will call your name and you can unmute. It could be a question for Dr. Knight. It could also be a comment, but if we can keep those brief to 3 minutes or less, just to make sure everyone has a chance to speak and you can respond to, again, to Dr. Knight's photography, to the things you heard in the audio, the recordings. You can share your own story. And obviously we encourage everyone, whether you speak or not, to listen deeply to each other and if you feel moved to respond. So if there's anyone that wants to respond, please do raise your hand. Otherwise, Dr. Cranston, I know you've thought a lot about these questions and maybe you can kick us off and just sort of respond to any of them or all of them. I would just love to hear about what you're thinking.
Oh, okay. So the first question, what went wrong with public housing? I don't think it's a question of what went wrong with public housing as much as when we discuss public housing, we're also talking about marginalization and segregation. Because when the Public Works Act was created, Public Housing Act was created in 1937, it really was to create more housing and affordable housing for those individuals who needed work close to military bases. And there was no problem there. It did change after the Second World War. After the Second World War, major change came in as Congress passed the 1949 Housing Act, which said that public housing would you could get a loan, and if you want to buy, because the suburbs were coming into existence by the time, the real estate agents were then directing people to buy homes out in the suburbs and people moving out of the city to those particular places. But unfortunately, those individuals who were, and I hate to use the word term minority, but those people of color, they could not get loans. They could not get the type of financial backing which they needed, which would have taken them to suburbs. In fact, they wanted to keep people confined to a particular area. They wanted to foster segregation. And that's exactly what they did. So did public housing go wrong, or did they create the type of environment which they wanted, which was strict segregation? From my perspective, they did exactly what they wanted and they got the results which they wanted. There have been a number of experiments in terms of violence which have been done in Yale, also in later years at Harvard, which had shown exponentially that if you take a large group of, they were using animals, of course, at the time, they were using rats in terms of labs because they're very human in terms of social behavior. And what happens to people when they're so overcrowded? And what happened exactly, what happened in those in tested environments is that the animals became very aggressive. They began to kill other animals. They actually joined gangs, which is, people were shocked when they went back and looked at those experiments. Well, all that information was readily at hand. They knew exactly what was going to happen when you crowded people into small spaces. So in that sense, it was a very controlled experiment in some sense. They knew the outcomes, but they persisted anyway because of the marginalization of individuals and who they did not see as equal to whites.
I love that answer because, sorry not to cut you off, but you just reminded me, I mean, there's this thing that I hear all the time that's like, the system isn't broken, it's working the exactly the way it's supposed to, right? Exactly the way the people who set it up. And you gave an example that like is very specific, one of those specific ways how that happens, right? How those controlled experiments, you know, continue to operate. Yeah.
I don't know if someone else wanted to speak. I didn't want to hog the whole, you know, the whole science of someone else wants to speak about that.
We got a quiet room today. we don't have anyone with their hand raised or anyone in the chat. So I think we have mostly listeners, okay. Folks that are just listening and absorbing, I'm sure. Okay. You can also write something in the chat too, if that's helpful.
I guess your next question is what worked? What worked against all odds was the fact that until you get to the late 70s, people maintained their humanity. Not that they lost their humanity later, but they maintained their humanness. You had the Boys Club, you had individuals who took it upon themselves literally to be your mom and dad. So if I was going to do something, someone would say, I'm going to tell your parents. Now, nothing scared the hell out of you, like someone saying, hey, you know what? If you continue doing what I think is incorrect, I'm going to correct your behavior now, and I'm going to tell your parents. I was scared to death. And so it was not uncommon for you to have extended family within the community. You may or may not have known those individuals. They may or may not have known your parents, but we didn't disrespect them. We respected our elders. And that's not something you find so common today. The elders were individuals who literally kept us in line. They made sure that we stayed out of trouble. They sometimes might give you a little extra money if you were going someplace, you're trying to get on a bus. I can remember someone saying, do you have money to get on the bus? And I said, no, I was going to, kind of go through the back door. And they said, that could cause you some trouble. It only cost a quarter in those days to get on, but the quarter was a lot of money. And they would give you a quarter and you could get on a bus. And, you know, next time you find me if you don't have a quarter, and I'll give you a quarter so you can get to where you're going. And that's what they were keeping me out of it. They were keeping me from going to jail or being hurt by perhaps a correction officer or policeman, or in essence, they function as an extended family.
Yeah.
We had other individuals who started, there were the Hornets. My dad started a marching group himself. There was a drum and bugle corps, which there was also, the Boy Scouts, the Girl Scouts, there were church groups. So there were a lot of groups within the community which filled our time. Not only the Boys Club, but there were also other groups which, you know, filled our time. There were after school programs. So there was a lot that was taking place. And as someone had stated in their oral interview, there were in each building, something specific for that particular building. So you had baseball teams. So we had, my building was 140. We played against 150. I'm sorry, I was 150. We played against 111. We played against 140. So there was baseball teams. My dad started probably the only Black hockey team. He spent a lot of time at the Boys Club. He worked at the Boys Club. And he went to a lot of the Blackhawks games. I don't remember us ever being able to, being allowed to go to a hockey game. But he knew Stan Mikita. He knew the other individuals who were part of the hockey team, and they gave him hockey pucks, sticks. They didn't start off with skates. With the ice skates. They start out with skates. They would skate around with the, and you know, push the puck back and forth. There were the goalies. Eventually, people learned how to ice skate. They never lost a game. They never lost a single game. They would play groups in the suburbs, and they were extremely good. They would do some hip checking. If you got hit by, if you got hip checked by any of the guys from boys club, you were going down on the ice, and you were going to have some problems. So they were extremely good at stick handling. So there was always innovation. There's always somebody doing something that was innovative. There was not a, I'm trying to think of it, planned activity in the sense that people sat down and said, okay, what's your 2-year plan? What's your 4-year plan? And what do you think things are going to like in 5 years? Mm-hmm. I don't think anyone even conceptualized that. It was right here, right now. This is what we need. This is what I'm going to do. And they did it. Did they receive any money? No, there was never any money. There was no non-for-profits as such. That said, hey, we're going to go give you guys some cash. There were individuals who did come into the community that were philanthropic. So we'd have Christian groups that would come in and have us sing religious songs. And we would sing, okay? So, we're singing. What they didn't see was the fact that everybody went to church. I mean, if you look, there was Greater Union. There was Pilgrim Rest, which I attended as growing up. Lots of churches. They never saw the churches. As far as they were concerned, we weren't Christian, and they were Christianizing us. You know, once again, back to that colonial modality, they didn't see us as Christian. They were going to Christian us. They would give us the little green Bibles. I think they're called the Gideon Bibles. And they would have, they would come in every Saturday and say, do you know Jesus? And we go, and we're looking around at each other thinking, do we know Jesus? There's a church. There's a church every 40 steps, there's a church. And, you know, but they could never see that. What we learned very quickly was, we'd say, no, but we're getting there. And what would you get? A choke sandwich.
Yeah.
What is a choke sandwich? Well, 2 pieces of bread and cheese. And why is it a choke sandwich? Because they didn't give you anything to drink. So you're trying to get this sandwich. You take a bite. And you're trying to get the sandwich down, and it would get caught somewhere in between there, and you would start choking. And so we flavored it a choke sandwich. But you got something to eat. So, then we would tell them, you know, hey, we're getting close. Did you read John? I think I was thinking about reading to John. Well, read John by next week. Here's a sandwich. Great. Next week, did you read John? You know, I got a little bit through, but I wasn't quite sure what they were discussing. Here's a sandwich. Okay, fine. That was great. So you knew you were going to have at least a sandwich on Saturday, and we got there. So what worked? A lot of innovations.
Yeah.
Tremendous amount of innovation. Nothing coming from the city, but coming from the community itself. Lots and lots of innovation.
Yeah. No, that's great to hear. I mean, when you talk about innovation, it reminds me of the museum's entrepreneurship hub. Which is really inspired by resident stories of informal economies and cooperatives that emerged out of public housing by necessity and, you know, creative folks just, you know, working together in proximity and so many, you know, great talents that came out of public housing that were able to connect and work together and create whole new sounds and you know, lots of different contributions to the culture. It looks like we have another person that is interested in speaking. And I believe it's Crystal Palmer, who's actually Assistant Director of Resident Engagement with Chicago Housing Authority and also a beloved member of the NPHM board from the beginning and a former resident of Henry Horner who still lives in the neighborhood. So we'd love to hear from you, Crystal.
I've got to know about a train, so I may go in and out.
Okay, we can hear you.
Okay, great.
So, first of all, I appreciate listening to his story from him. I really do, because it spoke to a lot about Henry Horner and his relationship to Henry Horner. So I was glad to hear that he actually came from Henry Horner and know a lot of history from Henry Horner. So I was really glad to hear that. Sorry, I'm off. Hold on for a second.
You're good. Crystal is someone that we also...
You had a couple questions, Tiff.
Yep.
Can you relay those questions again?
Sure. What went wrong with public housing? What worked? And what do you wish had been done differently?
Okay, so let's do the what went wrong with public housing. First of all, Henry Horner was the best place I ever lived to date, even during the hardest times. Still was family oriented, as he stated, and as many of your speakers, the people that were on recorded stated, is the best place ever. What went wrong? I think the government is what went wrong, because as the young man spoke about public housing in the beginning, how it was in the beginning, it was a wonderful utopia kind of a place to live. The grass was clean. The buildings were clean. You couldn't walk on the grass because you got a ticket. Families were together. And then the other thing that he talked about, that people that moved in the project, they would always say you had to fight in order to become part of the community. And that was oh so true. So many people had to fight, and that's how we became family. I had to fight with a family when I was 13 years old. That's 50 years, and we've been through every single thing together with each one of our families. And those are the kind of relationships that come from the project. So the greatest thing is that there were a lot of people that loved each other, that treated each other like family, even though we were not birth family. All right, come another train. I'm sorry. You had one other question.
Yeah. What do you wish had been done differently?
That the government had invested in our lives. Basically, that the government had invested in our lives and put in what they put in at first, and not treated us like we were lab rats, because it was a project. It didn't become project because it was a high rise, because it was an experiment that they didn't think would work. Mm. And it actually worked. Mm. You know, they, you know, stopped investing in our communities, yeah, into the buildings and the infiltration of drugs. You know, everything is designed. You know, things are designed to turn out the way they turn out. You know, they got rid of, you know, when Martin March about the poor housing in our communities. All right, let's fix it, build some houses, you know, so people won't have to live in squatter. They won't have to live into these kitchenettes and, you know, all this different type of housing that was substandard. And once they did that, well, eventually it was going to run out. And one of the damaging things that happened to public housing is that people that got jobs were no longer able to stay there because their rent would be increased. So we lost all those valuable people. Mm. That would encourage other people to get a boot up and move out. Everybody didn't buy a house. A lot of people did buy houses, but everybody didn't. They just couldn't afford the rent, you know, to live in a project, which was a very nice place. A lot of people didn't even have bathrooms. They had to share bedrooms. They had to share beds. So this is something, this was a come up for our family.
Yeah.
So, yeah, the government could have done better. Like the government could do better now.
Yeah, that's a theme, I think, for sure. Thank you so much, Crystal. I'm glad you're here. Thank you for that. So we have two other people I'm going to shout out. First, we have Michael Rogers. I believe this is our another board member who is also a public housing alum. Feel free to come off mute if you want to say something. But I see you have the drum and bugles, and now you have to gonna come off mute to make me pronounce it correctly. Bugle Corps at Henry Horner were iconic in the city. Major Adams was legendary in mentoring people. So some folks, just reading that out for those of you that can't see it in the chat. If anybody wants to respond to that after we go to Nakia. Nakia, are you there?
I'm sorry. My children in the background and it's competing noise. So okay. I definitely appreciate the presenters, learned so much from those before us. I would just, with the question about number two, what works, as an advocate for Section 3, I actually just spoke to another public housing resident who doesn't know what that is, but I would say, you know, within HUD, the opportunities to empower residents backed by finances, Bertha Gelke, and all of those type of people, you know, to actually give both the funding and the opportunities for empowerment when we talk about crime, you know, she worked on that. It was community-based, community-led, community-driven. And I think any of the policies and practices that took away from this paternalistic misnomer about poverty, where people that are in public housing cannot, you know, handle from business to crime to all of the other things. So I think that all of the things within HUD that I think they still have not lived up to what they were meant to do, the fact that lawmakers just put those laws in for Section 3, as well as the funding for residents, I think those things work because those are the best investments. Always invest in the residents.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I'm hearing that from you and from Crystal. For sure. That's the investment in the people, right? It's like, so basic, but it's something that, people have been asking for generations, and really, you know, it's something that's way overdue. We have anyone else? This has been a really great conversation. We are recording. We're going to go back and take some notes and think about our work and how this this conversation can impact, you know, the work that we do, not just in events, but with building our museum. For those of you who are not aware, we're based in Chicago and we are building a physical home in a area that was, it still has public housing, but the Jane Addams Homes is no longer there. And so we are moving into the last remaining building. Our building was actually, you know, advocated for as a museum from public housing residents who were displaced from that community and want their history and their culture to continue and to be, you know, connected so that it actually makes a difference and makes an impact. And this history is not forgotten and erased. And so everything that we do is inspired by the stories of residents and bringing in folks like you all who think and care deeply about, you know, your fellow neighbors and want to create a better society. And so thank you everyone for being here. We just have one more slide. We're going to start to wrap this up. Just to tell you about some of the things we have coming up. So I'm sure there's some folks in the room that know the Candyman legacy of Chicago, which comes out of the Cabrini Green neighborhood from the 1992 film. You know, I've heard the true story from residents through oral history. So we might do, you know, some oral history, sort of bringing in some of that, but this specific program is going to be at the Hideout on next Tuesday, so a week from, so sorry for those of you who are not in Chicago, this is an in-person event, but we're going to be doing some trivia with Paul DeRica at the Newberry, and we're sort of coming up with some questions, not only about Chicago history and public housing, but also about sort of Black horror and Afrofuturism and speculative art, thinking about, you know, different sort of inspirations connected to the film, but also connected to Chicago history and public housing history. So that should be really fun. And then we have our ongoing Out of the Archives series, which if you enjoyed tonight's program, you will enjoy Out of the Archives, because it's pretty much, you know, just listening to oral histories that are gathered and collected as under a theme, which comes from one of the residents' quotes. So here we have Doris and Mike Johnson, who are father and son, who come from Cabrini Green, and their stories are included along with a few other residents whose stories we have in our archive. So we'll continue to keep you up to date. There's some links in the chat. I see a message that Melissa just sent directly to me. You might wanna send that to Dr. Knight, because it looks like it's for him. If there's anyone else that wants to say goodbye or any last comments in the chat, feel free to do so. It was really a pleasure. Thank you so much, Dr. Knight. Y'all can give some snaps for Dr. Knight. Really appreciate you and your work. yeah, we'll have to bring you back for a poetry program just so we can bring some more of that. I'm definitely a fan, so let's do it. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, I look forward to it.
Awesome, awesome. All right, y'all, have a good night and take care.
Thank you. Thank you. Take care.